Top of the afternoon, everybody. This is the WooFDriver coming at you live once again. You might hear Zorro in the background, some of the wolf back. You're live with us today on the amazing chase course. I'm about to turn the camera over. And we've been doing a lot of live broadcasts lately. Dogs have been very active, been able to get a lot of signal where I'm at, and lots of good stuff's happening. Stay tuned tonight, by the way. Britt will be bringing you the WooFDriver news, and she's got a continuation of last week's show. All kinds of good stuff. I'm about to turn it over, and you can watch Zorro. I'll explain this all to you as we go. Okay. Okay, guys. We're ready, Jimmy. Okay. And here's the wolf pack. They're waiting on a flag. This is what we do. We chase a flag. There's Princess there. There's Zorro there. There's Chase on the left side of Zorro. Got a flag attached to a string. This is referred to normally as lure coursing, but I've made it husky style. And there we go. You're going to see Zorro getting speeds of around 30 miles per hour. He's chasing the flag. And here he comes. And we'll try to keep the camera on, folks. Okay, Chase is trying to butt him off, cut him off. And Princess is going the other way for the flag because she's smarter than them all. Took a woman to figure that one out. Okay. We're going down the course. And see, what's happening is, this is part of their prey instinct. They're very prey-driven. Here they come flying. That's Chase and that's Zorro. Yeah, got it by Zorro. He's hard to get it by. What happens is, they're chasing a flag, if you will, that's on a string that goes round and round on about 4 acres. It's a powered by machine. As I said, this is referred to lure course, and it's normally a sighthound sport because sighthounds have such keen vision. But a lot of breeds can truly enjoy this. That's why I'm showing you the husky breed doing it now. Now the huskies have a lot more endurance than sighthounds. Oh, he's right on the flag right here, folks. I don't know if you can see it. So Jim stopped the flag. Jim's running the machine right now. Jim part of the WooFDriver pit crew. And Jim stopped the machine to fake him out, kind of like a cat and mouse. So lure coursing, like I said, most breeds can learn to enjoy this because, again, it goes at their prey instinct and their prey drive. Gives them a chance to really explore it. He's flying, man. Of course, I've got a mileage meter on him too, GPS collars, in case you're not familiar with me. That's how I track him. And, okay, now Jim just stopped it. It's going the other way. And there's Princess. And Princess is about 12 years old. And she's just as vivacious as ever. So they chase this flag. As I said, most breeds can learn to enjoy it. And see, Princess is confused because she didn't know the flag got away. Again, sighthounds, because they're so keen and they hunt with their sights. So therefore, this sport is a natural for them. With other dogs who are more scent driven, there's the flag, I'm showing it to you. They're going by scent and the flag has no scent. So it's harder for them to find, but just that little, when they pick up a visual on it, it drives them crazy and they go for it. Now, two of my dogs really enjoy it. You're watching Zorro and Princess right there. Here comes Zorro. You hear Princess yelling at the flag. And what we did was, I don't know if you can see this, but we actually had to make the string. You might have saw the flag go up in the air for a sec. We had to make the string go up in the air because the dogs were trapping the flag. They were getting smarter than we are. Well, that's not too hard. And they were actually trapping the flag. But traditionally in lure coursing, the dogs don't catch the flag, but we're dealing with huskies here, so anything can happen. Huskies are a breed of their own, of course. They're closest relation to the wolf. They're very independent and very prey driven, so very stubborn. And lots of endurance, much more than sighthounds. So therefore, I had to make this equipment. Okay, Zorro got it. Good boy, Zorro. Down. Good boy. So all this equipment is custom built because standard equipment out there for this sport, again, I call Amazing Chase. It's referred to as lure coursing. You can find some machines on the internet. None of them are really commercially available. They're available on the net, but they're almost all custom built to order. But they make a mold and they build them all the same. They're usually built with car batteries, because these are made to be portable. It's the Princess. Because people take them to fields and they set up courses and they change directions and they set them up in different areas and they have meets. It's really a pretty interesting sport. Some places, as I'm aware of, there goes Princess. Some places are actually, okay, so Zara, see, you see the flag going up in the air? That's why Zara's looking up in the air. Oh, we got it by Zara. He's already got by. He sometimes will step on the string to bring the flag to him, essentially. It stops the machine, and then he can run over to the flag or bring it to him. That's Chase. Chase is just here to mill around and jump on Zara when he can and his other Wolfpack buddies, namely Jag and Zara. Princess, he won't be jumping on because she says, I'm not having any of that. So with this sport, as I understand, they've set up courses, I believe in South Carolina, probably in some other states too, where you can actually participate. They have roped off sections, kind of like we're on a course here, have a bunch of different courses, and you can pay 10 bucks, 20 bucks, whatever it is, and give your dog a run. So right now, sometimes these machines overheat. That's the biggest problem with them. And that's why the ones I'm telling you that are available are the battery operated ones. They overheat very quickly. So what we did was we made our own electric versions. They're a little slower. These machines can usually run a flag around upwards of 40 miles per hour because that's the speed a sighthound can run, like a greyhound, if you will. And huskies, other breeds, a lot of other breeds, their high end's gonna be about 30 miles per hour. But the what was happening is because a sighthound does a lap or two and they're done, anything more and the machines overheat. So to make this husky proof, where they can do this all day if they prefer, I mean, Zara's literally gotten 18 miles out of chasing a flag before. That's right, you heard me right, 18. So that's a lot of times up and down this course. Remember, this course is about 4 acres, so a complete lap is about 5/8 of a mile, maybe a half a mile, if you will. And so I had to build these so they can run all day pretty much. They still do overheat, but they're not near as sensitive as the battery-powered ones. There goes Princess. I love watching her run. I love watching them all run, but because of her age, again, being 12 years old and being able to do these activities, really keeps her joints and her mobility. So arthritis is less likely to set in. She does have some arthritis. But because the drive is so great, the instinct is so great, her prey drive, she keeps going and going. And of course, I gauge her performance levels to make sure that they're safe and she's safe. But it really motivates her to engage. There goes Zara. The Princess is just on the other end of the course doing a little bathroom break. Of course, any activity we do really gets them to use the bathroom a lot, which is just another healthy aspect of active lifestyle for the dogs. Here's Chase, he's just milling around. Jag's over there. This course, again, this is kind of like a personal course. This is an area that I rent. It was previously a horse pasture. And as you can see, the gentleman that owns it lives in the house that you're getting a view of. Here, Princess, she's yelling at it. I'm just trying to give you a quick view, sorry. And by the way, these are cooling tubs. So it's very important, especially it's not hot, but it's warm out here. And we can do this all summer long as we have, as you see, an awning, we have a fan, we have water there, and we also have cooling tubs there. We come out here in the winter too when there's no snow on the ground in the colder weather. But this is a year-round sport. And if you have any questions, I know this is kind of unusual, I'm sure, for what you're... That's what I say. When you come to WooFDriver, you're going to see stuff you've never seen. And this will give you ideas. And you'll learn about things and other activities that dogs can get involved in. Earlier today, I don't know, I posted a picture. I haven't done the video yet of Gigi. She's our little 10-pound Chinese Crested. That's what I want to tell you. Almost any breed can compete at anything we're doing here. Some limitations and some, of course, different breeds are going to perform differently. But Gigi was on the bike with 3 of my dogs. Not all 4 of them, because there's just not enough room on there for her yet, on this dog scooter. I call it the rough board. But she did unbelievable. I've got a lot of video I got to go through and edit a little bit, so because it's endless. I just run the whole camera the whole time we're out there. But I've actually got a little video my wife made as we came down the driveway because she was just so in love with Gigi, enjoying herself, and I hope to post that soon too. As I said, tonight, Brit will be on live with the WooFDriver News, which is just all about dogs, happenings in the world, fun stuff. And Brit's unbelievable. I think a lot of you tuned in last week to see her show. She did two last week. She'll be on tonight. I'm not sure the time. I'm thinking somewhere around 10 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. And I know a lot of you have left questions for her and posted about how you named your dog and describing your dog in the comment section, which is great. If she didn't get to you last week, she hopes to cover and get to you tonight. So please be sure to tune in. There's always something going on WooFDriver. We're really creating a nice dog network here. I call it the All Dog Network, actually. We'll have a website soon. We're going to have a trainer called the Dog Counselor. His name is Dean Miller. And he'll be joining the WooFDriver team Sunday night, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. There's Princess. And he'll be taking all your training questions. Dean approaches training similar to what I do, but we're all individuals, so we all have individual techniques and ways we do things that you can pick up on, and what might work for one dog, what might not work for other one dog, you'll find another answer or another way to do it, maybe for a dog that doesn't take to one of my training method or his, so you can experiment with both. Zorro, okay. And you can see they're getting a little hot. I'll give you a stat on this soon. But I did want to mention, besides Dean, we have a woman who goes by Carol Motivates. She'll be coming on board too on the WooFDriver team. And she actually has a book that was just released to Cracker Barrel and Amazon. And it's about what we can learn from our dogs. Really interesting. She's a very knowledgeable person. She'll be going on next week, and I'll get you time on that. We'll have a place where you can go, kind of like a channel guide. It'll all be on the WooFDriver Facebook channel. But what times and time zones and all that good stuff will be coming on. So we got Chase being a little inappropriate. That's just a dominance thing. Zorro's the little brother here. So Zorro, even though he's the biggest, he's the most gentlest. And he, they like to, how can I say it, beat him up a little bit, show, flex some muscle on him, say they're tougher, and Zorro doesn't have a bad bone in his body, so he takes the beating. It's not really a beating, but he takes the abuse, just what brothers do to each other, and Zorro has enough of it, he lets them know, though. And they all have a wonderful relationship with each other. They will actually take turns sparring, if you will, the three males. Usually Princess doesn't get as involved because she's a little feisty for them sometimes, and she's older, and actually she gets a little more dominant than any of them do. My job is just to manage it all and keep it all in check. Out there in the real non-domesticated dogs, wolves, etc., they have a hierarchy, and or that's how the wolf pack survives in the wild, because each pack member gets its own standing in the pack, and of course there's always an alpha, and as time goes on and the alpha gets older, the dogs will the other wolves or dogs, whatever it is, whatever kind of pack you're talking about, will challenge the other dogs or the alpha dog for that dominant status. So it's a little harder when you have, especially a breed like the Husky that has a lot of those wolf-like instincts. It's, they can, Zara said, I had enough, took off on them, Chase kind of got the word there. But they really will test the water, so it's my job to manage them and let them know acceptable behaviors to prevent these arguments and bickering and everything else that can evolve. Again, I'm a Husky expert. My training works for almost all breeds. Husky's one of the toughest to train. So whatever you learn from me will most likely work with your breed. And if you have a Husky, it's going to work with the Husky too. Some of the training is... Whoa, we lost a string. Hey, guys. So sometimes the string broke there. It's a little dry, and depending on conditions, the strain can get too tall or too tight and or too loose, and then Zorro grabs it, whatever, and it breaks. But what's real nice about it is as it breaks, it doesn't hurt anybody. We've had the string actually get caught in the dog's fur. No problem at all. That's the only issues we've ever had. Nobody's ever got hurt on it. The only thing it could do is if they put it in their mouth, they could cut their tongue. I shouldn't say really cut their tongue, but if they sit there, because as soon as we see them do it, we stop. The flag has a tear-off quality to it, so it'll tear, but they can bite their tongues also from just being excited. A lot of dogs do that, and my dogs have done that. So this is a very safe sport, and it also teaches them something very important, and that's to play with each other or to hunt. They know how to hunt together because that's what a wolf pack does, and this is, again, a prey-driven sport, but it teaches them that one dog gets it, passes it on to the other dog. Don't fight about it and don't fight over it. So it helps me teach them to manage that in that aspect. Love to answer any questions you may have. Sometimes these feeds are funny and they don't show me the question. So I have another phone with me. I'm broadcasting by phone. And I'm going to try to check that to see if anybody's asking any questions that I'm just not seeing on the feed. And I'll be right with you shortly. But again, any questions you have, please go ahead and post. And that's going to be for Britt tonight too, when she's on. And we love the audience interaction. That's why we're here, all of us. So I'll be right just checking it out right now. And seeing if anybody's got any questions. It looks like, folks, we have a lot of comments. Okay, sorry. Okay. I'm going to go through this question by question. Julie, thanks so much. Love Huskies. She said she takes care of one and how beautiful. Huskies are just a beautiful breed. Huskies, unfortunately, and one of the reasons I'm sharing all this, because they're one of the most abandoned breeds, because people get Huskies and they don't realize, because they're so attractive, but they don't realize what their energy requirements are or their energy release requirements, and therefore they have an insatiable appetite for activity, and they drive people crazy if they don't get the proper activity, digging holes in the backyard, escape artists they're known as, going through the trash, just doing all the things that unwanted behaviors. The Husky specializes in that when it doesn't have the appropriate exercise outlet. So thanks so much, Julie. I really appreciate it. And Myra, I believe it is. Love your dogs. Beautiful, beautiful dogs. And they look like they're in the snow there. How awesome. Thanks so much for sharing. Pam, no, he isn't going to quit. Zara, Chase isn't going to quit doing what he's doing. And Zara's not going to quit chasing the flag. And there's Princess in the water, by the way, just taking a break. And this is nice when the string breaks. And that happens maybe once every couple times we're out here. They gives them a break too. I'll give them a break if a machine actually performs better than we expect and doesn't go down, whatever, I'll give them a break, because especially depending on the weather, we'll just stop the machine and it won't be as attractive to them if it's not running, of course. Hey, Turbo, I believe. Thanks so much. Gloria, thank you. Yes, they love to run. Yeah, cooling off. That's right, Terry. Tracy, that's what they do. They love it. There's Chase in the water now. He's doing a little fishing. He puts his snout down in the water and goes fishing, I say. So, yeah, please keep the comments coming. I'll check them on the other phone there. And you're watching Jim fix the machine. Princess. She's just eating something, so. Usually there's nothing on the course. We're the only ones here, but I just want to check it out. Good girl. And sometimes she's just digging through the soil. Damn, we're back. Uh-oh, Zara got it. Did he get it? Zara got the flag right. Oh! Good boys. Good boy, Zara. So we're back up and running now. Here's Zara. I'm going to give you all views I can. Check Princess out. And she barks at it when she can't get it. Oh, by the way, we're going to do a mileage check here, folks. We did just get out here. Zorro is, this is my GPS controller. I don't know if you can see it, because I can't quite see it on the screen. I'll read it to you. He's got actually 2 miles in right now. His average speed is 10.66 miles per hour. So I don't know if you follow us when we're doing our free range, and usually speeds are 5 to 7 miles per hour. So he's going 3.5 miles plus faster than a normal pace because he's so excited, so driven by this lure coursing. Chase is virtually just a mile because he's just here to... He's just here for the beer. I mean, just here to have fun. And not, he's not working. He says, I'm not doing that. Jag's just resting, as you see. That's all he does. And they can do anything they want. And Princess is at 1.5 miles. So Princess, we like to get, I'd like to see her get anywhere from 5 to 10 miles out here. And there she goes. And Zorro, I'd like to see him get anywhere from 10 to 15. There she goes. Love watching the dogs run. And this is a great area. We can stay here as late as we want. And how nice, because the gentleman that owns the property, he owns a few properties, and I believe he's away. There's another family that lives here that he rents a house to. I'll try to get Princess right there. There she is. So if you ask, if you're asking why the antennas are on their collar, those are how the GPS controller communicates, so we can get the mileage readings. I can also do a page, like a tone. I use these collars for free ranging. That wouldn't be necessary for here, but I could do a page tone if I have to. And Jim's actually going to make a new flag for us. You putting a new flag on, Jim? Okay. So that's why they wear those. Here comes Zorro, smiling away. So this is really an unusual sport, and believe it or not, I got into it by just, I think, seeing it on the internet. Again, I'm always looking for activities that my dogs would like to engage. Reason being, because they're huskies, and they're not like other dogs. They don't like chasing a ball, and walking them just doesn't work. They've got just too much energy and too much drive, and on a leash, they pull like there's no tomorrow. Now, depending on the area you live, you might have to just have them on a leash, but that's why I have ways like with a bicycle or a scooter, because that's kind of like walking them on a leash, but you can go at least twice as fast as you can walking, so therefore you don't have to be as physically fit, and you can give your husky a workout like that. There they go. See how they go round and round, and then they jump in their water, and the water is so effective. See how their paws go on there, and their pads, they actually sweat on their pads, but it's not near as effective as a human. That's the problem with dogs. Their biggest downfall or inefficiency is cooling themselves down. Excuse me for 1 sec. Hey, I'm on a live broadcast. Can I call you back? I'm on a live broadcast. Do you need me? Okay. So, sorry, it was Mrs. WooFDriver checking in. So, they're very inefficient at cooling. That's why they have to be so careful when you do activities with them, because they overheat very easily. And it's warm for a husky if it's above negative 20. I mean, they're just so built for the cold. Now, of course, in the warmer months, they shed their undercoats. Princess. So that means that they just then have one layer of fur. And that one layer functions, believe it or not, to help keep them cool. Some people will shave them. I don't believe in doing that, because the fur actually helps protect them against sunburn and running through anywhere they might run. If they get through a sticker bush, through thorns, whatever, it'll protect their skin, and it aids in cooling them. Also, what I do is a nice fine misting system. You can spray them with a real fine mist. That can act almost like a sweat, because the mist will not saturate their fur, but wet it enough, make it moist enough to evaporate and create, as it evaporates, like when a human sweat would, it actually aids in cooling them. So you'll see me, I'm big on this. I've bought a couple misting systems and made a couple also, and put them on my dog carts so I could run the dogs in the warmer weather. And misting them under their body is super effective, because that's where their internal organs are. Princess. Now, Zara was faster than that flag right there running. Now, I didn't bring the radar gun. I keep that princess barking at it. Forgot to bring the radar gun. I apologize. Because I can tell you their average speed on my GPS controller, but it doesn't have a max speed. It's a Garmin product. For some reason, they don't have a max speed on this. And here comes the two of them. Look at this. Picture perfect. Zara, he's just moving at a trotting pace there. And Princess has found a place to mark. So it's simply beautiful out here. The temperature's around 78. And in our time zone, I don't know where you're watching from, it's 5:41. We hope to be here for a couple hours. At least till we get the mileage we'd like to get. Tomorrow it's scheduled to, supposed to rain here, so got out here late, and one of the reasons was it was raining this morning, and we go out in the rain sometimes, but since we were pretty active so far this week and we've got other activities planned, I wasn't going to push it. I didn't have to go out and get wet. The dogs don't care. That's another thing. We've got our little 10-pound Chinese crest that I was telling you about, and she doesn't like getting wet, but usually our dogs don't like doing what we don't like doing. So she just learned it because my wife doesn't like taking her out and doesn't like getting wet. But if I took her out a few times in the rain, she would learn the rain's not going to melt her. And she would actually learn to enjoy it because it would, in the warmer months, keep her cool. Of course, she can't go out in the warm, in the colder months without a lot of protective gear because she's hairless. If I didn't mention that. See, you can see Princess over there. It's just beautiful, isn't it? These cooling tubs, by the way, are a Rubbermaid product. They're commercially available at like Tractor Supply, Home Depot, that kind of place. Had these for years. They've lasted me. And these are, I think, the most shallow ones. It gives the dog a chance to lay down in it if it wants to and easily keep its head above the water, especially if the dog is not real tall. Like Princess is not. She's about average height for a husky. But she can lay down in there and, again, cool her underside, which is most effective. Okay, so Chase is still harassing Zara, but you know, it's all in good fun. I mentioned it yesterday. A veterinarian, when I first got into dogs, 20 years plus back, when I was considering getting a second dog, I was consulting with him, and I said, hey, what do you think about another dog? And he said, you know what? Only a dog knows how to play with another dog. What he meant by that is, they know the limits. I see sometimes, and you might have seen this on some of my videos, my dogs will pull each other by the tail across my back patio. And, you know, it was all a, it's all a game with them. And I mean, that's part of how a real wolf pack would play. They keep testing each other and they keep sharpening their skills for really hunting prey, which obviously we're not doing. But that, they know what they can tolerate and what the other dog can tolerate, especially when they're well-trained. So they really go at it hard, but in the proper way so nobody gets hurt. And I would never pull my dog like that, of course. I would say, wow, that's too hard. But when you watch them and you watch their interactions and how they gauge themselves, it's truly remarkable. That's my dog bus over there. I have two trucks I use for the dogs. And the reason being, that's like the economy ride when we don't need to carry a lot of equipment, like the sled, bikes, etc. Then we can take the small truck, which I call the dog bus. And it's just real small, and it does have dividers in there. Chase and Zorro stay together. Princess and Jag are divided, and they're divided from the others. Just because Jag's a little nervous. When you get nervous dogs or dogs that are fearful, that's what aggression's all about. That's why they become aggressive. So Jag in the truck or in anything moving, he gets, and not on the dog bike, but in a vehicle, he gets a little unsure of himself. We've built a lot of confidence, but it's just easier to let him have his own area, and it's a very safe way to travel. Princess is very, on the other hand, she's just very energetic and hyper, even at her age. So when she's in the truck, she'll pace back and forth. I think we have a little ongoing joke. She'll do a couple miles just to pacing before we get to where we're going. So she might upset the other dogs of all her activity. So we keep her separate too. And when I say separate, they're right next to each other. But, you know, a lot of dogs travel in kennels, and it's really super safe. That's pretty much what my compartments work out to be, is kennels. But the seat is just the kennel, because it's strictly the van is strictly for the dogs. And it's similar in the big truck, except for there's more room for a longer trip, and there's more space to carry gear, and there's a roof rack and everything else. So I'm going to check questions now. I'm sorry I have to check the other phone, but it's not notifying me for some reason. So love to answer questions, though. That's why we're here. And let's see. Okay. I'm just looking at the comments. And this is sometimes when I hear people complaining, it's amazing. So we have somebody who posted that it was cool for the husky in heat. They are winter dogs. They need to stay cool. They have too much fur for summer activities. They walk now and then, but not that. So, you know, I don't want to say that somebody doesn't know what they're talking about, because for them, I guess they do, but I've been doing this for 20 years. Now, there's a difference between really working a dog in heat. I would never, ever do that, or letting a dog get activity in the heat. That I do. Properly gauged, as I explained. I've gone as far as exploring heart rate monitors and working with my veterinarian to try to figure out a target heart rate for dogs, so we could really figure out what their true potential is. But because it's not a big... people don't explore that. We never could really figure it out. There wasn't enough information available. I'm just showing you Princess. So I have the polar monitors that are actually for horses. So they're coded separately, because I had them on all my dogs. But we could never figure that target heart rate out. Maybe the research is there now. That's going back a few years. So I mean, I do everything in my power to keep my dogs as safe as possible, yet as engaged and as active as possible. If Princess was sedentary, you take a couple weeks off with her, arthritis is going to set in. She's going to have a tough time getting up even. But because of all this activity, at the proper parts of the day and with the proper cooling equipment and common sense, we can get out almost every day. Yeah, believe it or not. So people are just, you know, a lot of people say to me, oh, your husky's hot. I know when the husky's hot. I know my huskies. I've been doing this for many, many years without incident, may I add, without incident ever. So I'm very proud of that. I'm a lot more cautious than you might think from what I'm showing you, but everything here is thought out to the nth degree and managed to the nth degree. Okay, let me get to some more questions here. So, I like addressing them online because it's a little hard for me to type sometimes. So, let me see here. And okay, Alicia commented. Trying to get to the video. As you know, I post a lot of stuff. I'm really trying to keep everyone as informed as possible. We got a nice breeze going on up here too, so it's truly wonderful. Please keep posting your questions. I'll be right with you. Okay, this thing doesn't want to cooperate. I apologize again. Okay, you're getting views of Chase of messing with Zara. Okay, folks. Okay, we got some more. Thanks so much, Alicia. Alicia says it's awesome. Thank you so much. I'm giving you a view of Jag laid out now. are GSDs close to wolves like Malamutes and Huskies? Barbara asked a great question. Are German Shepherd dogs close to wolves like Malamutes or Huskies? They're similar, but they're not as close as the Husky. The Husky is more of an Arctic breed or northern breed. And the German Shepherd, that's one of the reasons the German Shepherd doesn't have that in them. That's why they're so trainable. Because this northern breed, hearing some of the wild farm animals around. What's up? Okay, machines are down. Cool, that's good. They're due for a rest. So they're not as closely related. German Shepherds are wonderful dogs. In fact, the gentleman master trainer I learned everything I know from, who was my mentor, was his breed of choice. At one time he had 20 dogs, I don't know, a zillion dogs, because he used to train dogs for the police and the military, and he had all the kennel setups in his house. And they were trained like I've never seen any dogs. Truly incredible. And what I mean by that is normal training, way beyond normal training. I mean, he had them trained where one day he pulled up in his truck and he called each dog out individually. Each dog came to him one at a time. It's like a school bus or something. It's like a van. And they took their appropriate positions by his side. It was very impressive. So he was a master Schutzen trainer. Schutzen is protection work for police and military dogs and German Shepherds. That's usually what they use. So he would have his Shepherds, and they would intermingle with the Huskies, and it was truly incredible. And because my Huskies, three of them, well, the three now are white. Huskies in the past were all white. I've got the one Zorro, who's a more traditional looking Husky. He's got the Malamute in him too. He's got the mask, as I said. We would kid, he'd be like, those dogs should be like white German Shepherds. They should be, you know, that trained. And you can get more out of a German Shepherd in the sense of for different activities versus the Husky is built for its specialties, is pulling and running and that kind of stuff. German Shepherds are very physical and great dogs, but they are definitely a lot more trainable than the Husky. So they're not quite as close to the Wolf as the Husky or Malamute or the other northern breeds. So great question, Barbara. Really appreciate it. I'm going to peruse the list again. Hey, Mary, thanks so much for joining us really now. She probably saw Chase pumping a little bit on the Z-Man, Zorro. That's where that comment came from, I'm sure. Janet, great question. How old are they? They're all 6 years old, except Princess, right there. She's on camera now. She's actually better than 12, and she's the only female of the pack, except for if you're counting Gigi, who is learning to join the pack by running with the Wolf Pack. And Gigi's just 10 months, I believe. Betsy, great question. I give them, what kind of food, Betsy asks? I give them frozen raw food, and I actually feed it to them frozen. So it's an unusual one. You probably won't find many people. Most people take the frozen food and de-thaw it. But the Huskies, because again, they're a northern breed, they have the ability in the wild and the teeth to eat frozen foods. And they enjoy it, especially in the warmer months. Normally they would eat it in the winter months. Their prey they would find, they would come upon in the wild, wolves, etc., would be frozen. So that's when they normally would eat it. But I feed them year-round frozen food. Had this discussion with my vet, and been doing it for years with good results with Princess. So I feed a brand. I used to make my dogs all their own foods. I used to, something called, I know it might sound a little terrible, called the barf diet, bones and raw food. And I got into it years ago, again, from my master trainer, from his wife. She was another master trainer. And these people were nationally ranked with their Shepherds and in the Schutzen field and tracking and everything else. It was truly incredible. But read a book and did some research on raw feeding and fell in love with it. So I started feeding my dogs raw. And what I would do is I would actually juice them. What I mean by juicing them, not like you traditionally would think, I would take the pulp and feed it to them, where people take the juice and eat it. The pulp, because it makes the nutrients, when you're talking vegetables, biologically available for them. So that it simulates I know this is going to sound bad, but it simulates what they would find like in the guts of a deer. That's how broken down it is. And what, here comes Princess again, and what makes it, it's biologically available in the wild for them that way. So we put it in that state through a juicer. So I would do that, which was a big fat mess. My wife didn't like that, but I would create that. And then what she would do to hold that state, it only holds it for, I believe, an hour or two. And what I, you can see Jim's faking them out. It's great. He's doing that so Zara doesn't catch the flag. Zara hasn't caught as much today. We're on to his antics. Plus, it's a little warmer, so he's not quite as fast. They're taking their break. Actually, Princess, Zara decided the flag might be coming back. I'm not going back to the water yet. So it's only that biologically available to him for, I believe it's an hour or two after you've juiced the pulp. So I would freeze it. Oh, he got it. He got it, folks. Zara, good boy. So he's standing on the flag. Okay, we got it away from him. And there's nothing wrong if he gets it. It just, what it does is it, the flag gets smaller and smaller, and it's harder for them to see, and we got to put a new one on. Plus, he stops the game, the activity for a while till we get it back. He's the only one that does that. Chase just grabs him when he does it. Chase just grabs Zoro when he does it. Princess just has fun. Hey, Jim, you got your gate open. So we just keep the gate shut. That's where all the equipment is. So I would freeze the vegetable pulp, and I would actually use like dog bone shaped ice trays, pretty big ones actually, and I would make their food that way, because sometimes we would eat vegetables, and well, they would eat vegetables, and sometimes they would eat raw foods. Now, I'm only saying this because I'm going to tell you how it is. A lot of people don't believe this. Again, I'm way out of the box. You won't meet anyone like me ever. I don't do this anymore, but raw foods, raw bones, in a lot of cases are okay for dogs. So I would feed them, believe it or not, raw chicken, not when it's cooked or when the bones become problematic. Now, today I don't like to do it because there's just too many horror stories out there, but whenever you give a cooked bone, especially poultry bone, to a dog, that's when it can splinter and become problematic. When it's raw, it's a lot safer, put it that way. So I feed them that way, again, without incident, and it was incredible. It was like watching a lion. We would throw in the turkey wings, and they just loved them. They were healthy for them, and that's the way I would treat them. I would feed them raw meats, steaks. I would feed them raw salmon. Taking a break? Okay, cool. Feed them raw salmon and lots of other raw foods. What I do now is, because that became a lot of work, as you can understand, I found a diet from actually the author of the Barf Diet for that's commercially available, and I buy those frozen patties, which have the vegetables that are biologically available to the dogs and the raw meats and crushed bone. And that's what I give them. And I really don't give them any other bones. The only thing I give them are tendons. Anything that's fully digestible. Any tendon, I should say, that's fully digestible. And pretty much that's it. I also, for treats, I just give Old Mother Hubbard. It's not necessarily really part of any diet I found. I've just, from what I know, they've had no recalls. I feel safe with them. And can get them in bulk. And I don't make a staple out of it, but that's the only treat they do get. When I'm training a dog, I use hot dogs. And just human-grade hot dogs. Cut them. I cut them the size. If a hot dog's a quarter, for instance, I cut them that way. And then I split it into four. So real small pieces. And they go a long way. And you don't get the dog too full. So you can keep training them. And they absolutely love them. Just right out of the package. I don't cook them. They're already cooked anyway out of the package. So right now we're taking a break, folks, and while we're taking that break, I'm going to just walk you over to the equipment and give you a tour. Let me do this thing off. Jim, just going to give a tour of the equipment. Stay, Princess. That's Princess, stay. Good girl. Nope. Princess wants to get in here. Come on, pretty. Good girl. Stay good girl. Good. So what happens is, I'm just closing her out. And you can see what we do. We have a fan actually that runs on the machine to keep it cool, because I told you when we're running this machine, they have a tendency to get hot. This is our custom built machine, and there are two of them. As you can see, they're all electric. So they have an electric motor, and they plug into the wall there. And you can see all these car batteries, as I was telling you. And you can see the battery charger. That's how, what the extent we had to go to keep them charged. There's one of the battery powered machines and remnants of the other one. Very expensive equipment. It's all portable. That's why they're in those road cases. But they could only do a couple laps and they would totally overheat. So these electric ones work seamlessly for a while. They will overheat after maybe 20 minutes or 25 minutes of consistent running. But when they overheat, they protect themselves. They go off. The battery ones don't do it. So we actually had a little bit of a battery fire once. It wasn't anything major, but that's why we have a fire extinguisher now. So nobody got hurt. And the barn here is still standing. So that's pretty much how we do that. These wheels, this turns. The machine's turned on the belt, as you see, and then the platter turns, and the string is stuck in there, and the string runs is what the flag runs on. Okay, I'm gonna walk out now, so I'll give you a view of the dogs. Excuse me, Pretty.
Come on.
Good girl. Pretty's taking a break.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah, you can keep it down for a little while, Jim, whatever. So, yeah, Zara's taking a breather. How about that? So I'm gonna put the long-range lens on, folks, because it's a big course and you can't really see much. If I had to do that for the equipment, because that's a close quarter area. So let me just try to put this on. There we go. Yep, so that was my story about the raw foods. Hope you were able to hear that. Any questions on it you may have, I'll answer them. Refresh the feed here. Excuse me. Any questions? I'm open for them. Criticisms, as people were criticizing me for having the Huskies out in the heat, and anything else, I take them all. Okay. And part of the problem is, I mean, you can see I'm an expert at what I do. Part of the problem with broadcasting all this is, of course, everybody's entitled to their opinion, and everybody's had their own experiences and view situations at their own perspective, but what I'm doing, I know inside and out. My motto is expect the unexpected, but be prepared for it. Because every day dogs will surprise you with something they do, something that happens, something you weren't expecting. Some crazy thing crosses our path. We had a bear before. We've had bobcats. I mean, you just don't know. But have the appropriate means with you, or have the appropriate plan, so if the unexpected happens, you're able to keep everybody as safe as possible. Don't want to barricade ourselves inside of anywhere and not be able to do these activities, because they're perfectly safe. But you know, everything's got a little bit of risk. You can walk outside and God forbid get hit by a car. So, but when we talk about Huskies and heat, I'm a pro at it. I know exactly what I'm doing, and I won't even share things I've done because of the criticism I'll receive. But again, all without incident. So be that as it may, I'll share something with you that I will get a lot of criticism for, I'm sure. But I actually, when you work a dog in, again, not work's the wrong word, when you do activity sometimes in warmer temperatures at the right pace, cautiously, the dog builds endurance and gets even a better workout than you can imagine, because the heat automatically depletes them by at least 50%, usually, depending on the conditions. So when their performance level increases because of the way they learn to handle the heat. But that being said, that's only because I'm a pro and because I do it cautiously and with a lot of care in mind and with a lot of knowledge and a lot of preparation should something go wrong. But as soon as my dogs show the first sign of unnormal or abnormal distress, we're done and we're in a cooling mode. I mean, we're off any activity we're on, and we're inside of a cool facility. So, I find, now, you know, you're talking when you, this is a recreational hobby, even though it's a full-time job for me. But, you know, when you're talking mushers and people that run sled dogs, they're not going to do that kind of stuff, because their dogs are so work engaged that they're not going to get out there and perform on a lighter level, and they could succumb to the heat a lot easier. Okay, we got dogs. And again, we're laying down here just enjoying ourselves and having a great time. That's Chase and Zorro. Now Zorro gets up, he's probably ready to go, but the machine's still down. It works out really well. Okay, let me take any more questions here. Okay, I don't see any more questions. Really appreciate all the love everyone gives. And I appreciate all the, you know, when there's questions and disagreements and different ways of doing things, hey, I can learn too. I mean, I appreciate that. But I just, I want to make sure sometimes when we say people leave comments or something, they don't know the whole story. So sometimes I'd like, you know, you might need to dive a little deeper into the WooFDriver to find out exactly what the situation is going on. Okay. By the way, I did mention Britt's going to be on, and I'm going to try to check what time she's planning on going live tonight. She puts on a great show. It's so awesome, and it's not husky-centric like I am. Again, you can apply almost all my principles to most dogs, but she's talking about all dogs. So, okay, so she's probably around 8 or 9 tonight, and that's her plan. So tune in right here on the WooFDriver channel. I'm going to stay live with you. We're going to keep running the dogs, and hopefully you're having a great time. I'm just thoroughly enjoying myself when the dogs are. And I'll run the machine a lot of times. I have Jim here so he can help in case the machine goes down. He's pretty mechanical, as well as run it while, oh, look at Chase rolling over. I love that. While I can broadcast and bring it to you folks. And we'll do a mileage check. We haven't done that in a while. Let me check the old, let's see now that the sun is there. Okay, can this, let's see if this lens can focus on this. I don't think it quite can, but that says Princess has 3 miles in at an average speed of 7 miles per hour. That's pretty good for her. Okay. Put the camera that way. Zorro is at 4.14 and he's at 9.9 miles per hour. So Chase is probably, let's see what Chase is at. Chase is a mile and a half. Now, by the way, I forgot to mention that this area I'm at, we can do some free ranging here. There's, this is about 40 acres, I believe. So there's a 5/8 of a mile track that the gentleman who owns the property, he rents out his farmland too. And that's why you'll see soybeans, I believe, and corn behind it growing. But he had the farmer make me, that he rents the land to, make a track for me that I can run the dogs around. And I usually do that, but I don't have my vehicle with me today. It's been down. So usually have a little scooter and I just get up there. It's not like the other farms I go to where I have ATVs. I have the scooter that I run here because it's lightweight and I'm only doing 5/8 of a mile. But I'll usually, it's a nice cool down for the dogs. It'll get their mind off because they're, whoa, I thought that was an owl coming down for something. because they get so engaged in this that sometimes it's a good idea to take their mind off of it. Plus the dogs that aren't as engaged by it, it gives them a chance to get a little exercise. Today they did all get exercise because, as I said, we did an activity where we trained Gigi on the dog scooter. So that's where we're at, folks. Love to hear any questions you may have. I'll give you a quick 360. Touring the area for you. Looks like the gentleman's planting some trees here. And this is all fenced in. Now, it doesn't necessarily have to be for my dogs, but when we first came here, I preferred it till the dogs learned the lay of land. That way I could take my eyes off of them and run the machine and didn't have to worry, because as you can see, as we get further out, there's a little bit of a hill or a drop-off, and they go behind there, and I can't necessarily see them. Now, my GPS collar would tell me if they were out of range, but it just makes it easier. The fence was already here. We did When I first came here, we put the deer netting over it to keep the dogs and make sure they didn't go under it. And it's amazing. They learn the rules of the fence here. So at home, most people say, you know, you can't keep a husky on less than, sorry, we're trying to get the machine running again. And Zara's not cooperating. He says, I'm going to have my way with this. We call it the bird. It's the flag. Most people, almost probably any book you read, don't keep a husky unless than an 8-foot fence, and they'll dig out of it and all that good stuff. Well, there's a lot of truth to that, but on the activity these guys get, I never have them challenge my fence. My fence is 5 foot high, I believe, and it's got screen. They could climb it, and it's not something that I take lightly. I mean, we could make the fence higher. Actually, we scoped it to be higher originally, but I started working with the dogs when they were puppies, and I knew the fence was fine for them then, and I started putting collars on them that would let me know if they got near the fence line and their movements for the day, and they weren't challenging at all. I have cameras all over the house too, so I could see them if I was inside. And it just became, they never challenged a fence, so I've never upgraded it, and we've been fine, and all my neighbors know we're there and all that good stuff, but they've never gotten out, they've never challenged it. So it's truly amazing. And again, that's just because they sow their wild oats when they're out there doing the activities we do, and they get all this energy out of their system. They get, okay, here comes Princess. She's barking at it. I love this. Good boy, good girl. You can see them running together. It's Princess coming right by you. And now he's shortcutting it, because see what happens is they know how the flag, oh, she just barked at it. They know how the flag goes. And that's why on a tradition, oh, they're running fast. Most people will change the course. That's why when they're portable, you can change them all different. You can make a maze out of it. That's why I call it amazing chase. Therefore, they wouldn't be able to shortcut it. So they would have to run the whole way, but it really doesn't matter here. And you might have heard me use that term shortcutting before. Sometimes the dogs, when we're out free ranging, they will shortcut me. And I don't like shortcutting because they can take their attention off you. So if they think, she's barking at the flag, it's at you. If they think you're going in one direction, they'll get ahead of me, which is okay. But as soon as they start assuming my every move, that's when it becomes a problem, because they take their attention off of me. When they take their attention off you is when they get in trouble. You do want them to explore to their heart's content, but you also want to make sure that they always have you in the back of their mind, so they don't get too far away from you. They're cognizant of any turns you make and directions you go. You don't have to call them to it. They know. Their eyes are on you. And that's a WooFDriver tip there. She's a little tired. There she goes. Just when you think they're tired, they turn it on. Now, most people say, oh, isn't it hot for the husky? We got a good breeze going. And again, you see all the, oh, Princess got it. Look at her. She went down to the ground chasing that thing. She put it in her mouth. That's rare for her. But it's so exciting. It's so great and wonderful. Gibbs is playing with him. Okay, let me see if we got any questions here, folks. Again, I'm sorry, this is a Facebook thing. I can't always get them. Okay. Sorry about the flag, it looks like, folks. Okay. We are still rolling and live, folks. I'm taking any questions you may have. I am a WooFDriver. You're watching the Wolf Pack chasing that flag, right? Oh, can I not get it on there? You out, Jim? Okay, so one machine went down, but again, we have two machines, so we'll change it over. Okay. Thanks so much, Angel. Thanks to everyone. I appreciate it. Okay, let me show you this flag. I don't think I've done that. This is the flag, folks. That's all it is a caution tape. And it's caution because dogs chase it. Oh, did you see Princess? He took it right off. And by the way, hi, Chasey boy. Hi, good boy. You're a good boy, Chase. You're a good boy. boy, yeah. This is the pulley. So the string travels on there. It's not motor driven. It's just driven by that machine that I showed you earlier. And the string's right there. Look at Princess. She's looked like a third baseman there. She was down and ready for the flag to come down. Look at his arm. Now Jim's going to change directions. Playing cat and mouse with him. Ooh, she's ready for it. Lots of fun. Here they come, folks. Princess on my left, Zorro on the right. I'm going to see the flag right there? And that's Zorro chasing it. Boom. And Princess is still coming from behind. Here she comes. Not as fast. So, I told you about Brit's show tonight. Friday, we are going to hopefully do a live broadcast. We go midnight mushing. That's a whole other thing I hope to explain to you. But so we're on a dog cart in the middle of the night. Lately, we've been riding through the dawn. Haven't broadcast the last few, but I hope to broadcast this one. Next Friday, we're really going to have a special. We're having a professional ghost hunter join us. And we're going to be looking for ghosts with the dogs, paranormal experiences. And he's pretty well renowned in the area. Let's get the princess right here. Good girl, pretty princess. Busy man. And you can see the flag. He's headed right for the tubs. Right for the cooling tub. See how cool that is? They can do a lap, do a couple laps. They can chill, whatever they want, and they can jump into the tub anytime. So Jim tried to fake Zorro out. Let's see if Zorro can catch it. Oh, he didn't catch it. So, yes, folks, we can do this all day. Just watching the dogs go back and forth. Love it. Love anything they do. And, again, this is an activity because it's prey-driven. It's really driving them. So, because they're so engaged, they get a heck of a workout. It's exciting to them. So, you know, it's like us saying, hey, we're going to go lift weights at the gym. It's not that exciting to us, but if you say, hey, let's go do another activity, maybe some people, of course, like weightlifting. I used to do it myself. But maybe a softball game is a little more your taste. So you get excited for that softball game. Or somebody wants to jog, they get excited for the run. This is one of the activities they prefer. I'm not saying it clear enough, and I apologize. But the more an activity engages them, the more naturally they'll give, and the better workout they'll get. And the more they'll keep going. If Chase doesn't stop and hump them like he's doing. Chasey boy, that's not proper behavior. There he goes. Oops, sorry, I took the camera off. I forget. This camera's got a pretty zoomed in. We got Princess and Zorro right there. Yeah, so because this sport will drive them to sprint probably more than anything we do. So because of those sprinting speeds, that's one type of workout. So free ranging yesterday, we were at a hilly area. Climbing those hills is another type of workout. Strength building, endurance building, etc. Speed building is here. When we get on the bike, that's an endurance workout because you can get the most mileage out of them then. And people take that so wrong when you say you're getting mileage out of your dog. The dog, when we go to these farms that are 500 acres plus, your maximum you're going to get out of them is 10 miles. And that's not because they won't go further. It's just because it gets boring after a while. And it takes a while to do 10 miles off leash. It's just the way it goes. I mean, that can be an all-day affair. If we had a bigger place, maybe 1,000 acres, maybe we'd be able to get 20 miles. I don't know, but the dogs have a lot more in them is the bottom line. So what we do is we put them on a sled on wheels on the bike and we can go 15 or 20 miles at the dog's pace. So they can quench their appetite for the mileage. And again, running at their speed, but they can get some pulling in too if they prefer. And usually on the trails we run, again, these are wheeled vehicles, so just laws of gravity, once they start rolling, if it's level or downhilly, pretty much keep going. So I ride the brake most of the time. People are like, whoa, why's the dog's got to pull that? They're not pulling. I mean, they are pulling a little bit, but not what you think they are. I tell them, try going uphill. Dogs usually not going to pull you that way. I mean, don't get me wrong. Certain situations, they can pull, but not. It's not like people imagine. Now, when you get a whole team, when you're talking 17 dogs or 20 dogs in snow, it's a different story. That's the Z-Man. See, he's trotting along. Now, so he's trotting. So Jimmy went back with him the other way. So you can find, I talk about Jim, I talk about the dogs, I talk about all these activities. You can find all this information on 30-plus websites I have. I haven't done a count lately. And we are starting a new website, and it's brand spanking new, so if you go there, you won't see anything yet. But the All Dog Network website. And that's going to have all these videos that we've done live, sorted out nicely, so you can catch pretty much the rebroadcasting of them at your own pace. What you might want to watch, you can scan through them, etc. If there's something on there you wanted to see. I know they stay on Facebook, but the problem is they start getting lost in the shuffle and they're not sorted in any way. And because we have so many different specialists on the WooFDriver channel, those videos will get mixed in there. This will be sorted for you nicely on All Dog Network, and that'll be coming about in the next couple weeks. So look for it, please. Okay, I'm gonna check for one more comments you might have. Here's the pretty princess doing her thing. Sorry, the flag just went past and Princess just barked at it. Chase is seeing what is his buddy Zorro doing. Can he attack him? And that machine just overheated or just went into its protection mode. So Jim's going to switch it. As Chase is harassing Zorro. And Princess is just checking out the sights. And you know, we haven't done. We'll go over and say hi to Mr. Jagster. Jag's just minding his own business. Now don't get it wrong. Jag is he's a quiet type here, but when he wants to, we call him a prankster, when he wants to get something going on, he'll prank his wolf pack mates. Jag's already done about 3.5 miles today. Hey Jim, you're off here. You want me to put it on? You're off here. And here too. Hang on. So what happens is, I'm going to pick the string up and you just see, and put it on the pulley. Whoops. There. They come off sometimes. Got it. Hey, Jaggy. Spend some time with the Jagster here for a sec. Mr. Jaggy. How are you, bud? Okay, so Chase is seeing this affection. Okay, here comes the flag, folks. Did you see that come by? Zorro. Oh, Zorro says, I'm going to go get a drink. Jason boy. So I'm sitting, okay, Mr. Jagman. So, I don't know if you're getting this, but I'm here with the Jagman. Jaggy's getting a little loving. Okay, Miss Princess. She's talking to the flag again, folks. There she goes. And I'm just sitting here with the Jagster. Let's see if you can see that. I can't see the screen, so. Well, that's the Jagman. And hey, you're a good boy, Jaggy. That's Chase. Chase is debating whether he wants to come over here and get some love or not, or if he's gonna stick with his crew. Okay, so Jag went over there. Jag said, okay, Dad, I got enough loving. Okay, we got three of them coming now. This should be interesting. Okay, Chase, let me put the screen on. Sorry, though. I'm just putting the camera on, folks. Sorry. Extended lens so it can up you better. Okay. Any questions you may have, feel free, shoot them on over to me, please. By all means. Let me try to see what we got going on. That's a three of them. What's that? Break, cool. Taking a break. And you're just... And, we're having a great time out here, folks. Love to see your comments, questions. Okay, looks like we got some more questions. Good. Answer them. Give you a shot of the dogs there. Okay. Hi, Janet. Thanks so much. Janet said she enjoys the live feed. Thank you very much. And they had a Siberian Husky and they want another one. When the time comes, they have a rescue right now. And, hey, rescues are some of the best dogs. I'm going to give you a view of Princess. Now she's laying down in the tub, folks. Can you see that? Okay. She got her underbelly wet. She's going to get out and shake it off. That's so wonderful to hear, Janet. Thanks. It's informative. Thank you so much. And anytime anybody has a question, please, even if it's not on the live feed, go ahead and drop me a line. I'm happy to answer and comments and anything else you may have. I really appreciate it. Any other questions? I am here and I am live right now. At least I think I'm live. Oh, thank you. Sherry says she likes watching us when we're live. Thank you so much. Right now, Barbara's asked where we're at. Right now we're in, I'm going to say, what part of Maryland is this? We're towards Hanover, Pennsylvania. Not quite that far north, but in that vicinity. I don't know exactly what part this is in Maryland. It's about 45 minutes from my home. I travel quite a bit to get to these places. Here's Jason Zorro. So usually it works out really nice, though, because I feed my dogs once a day, and you usually don't want to feed a dog after an activity. They say a half hour, but minimal for me is an hour. So it's usually it's 45 minutes to an hour home by the time they get fed, an hour at least. And it's just so, it's better for them because you won't have as much of a chance as bloat. Bloat can be fatal, and bloat usually happens. It can be from air, from water, from food. Too much, too quick, a lot of heavy panting, whatever, and some dogs are more prone to it than others, but it turns the stomach upside down, and as I said, it can be fatal. You can, if your dog is prone to it, you can have your dog, it sounds terrible, but you can have their stomach stapled, and it would prevent bloat. So you can talk to your veterinarian about that. I don't have that with my guys. I mean, bloat can happen for other reasons too, but if you feed them too close to energy to a workout, you can suffer. They can suffer bloat. It's a more of a common thing. Hey, Z-Man. So the Z-Man. Let me take the photo off. Hi, buddy. Hi, buddy. Z-Man came over to give me some love here. Hi, good boy. He's been working his butt off. Good boy. Oh yeah, I love that slobber, sir. That's the Z-Man. He's just chilling and enjoying his day. And you see Chase. Chase, where's Zorro go? It's good, Jim. Good, just chilling, buddy. Everybody can use the break. Good boy, Zorro. So you might have seen yesterday on our feed. I know. We did a live feed of training them to ride the motorcycle. I don't know if you caught that. That's on there too. And pretty remarkable. It's something I've always wanted to do. Never had the time to do it. And never had the right equipment. But as I told you, what we do with the dogs, I always look for ways to interact even further with my dogs as much as possible in my life. So what happens is I have a seat I found built by Beast Riders, and they're actually in Maryland too, which is pretty convenient for me. I was able to go there, tour their facility, help them fit it on my bike. And it's a custom-made product to your bike and your dog's size. So I got a general size that would fit my bike, but that would accommodate all four of my dogs. And it takes them anywhere from 2 to 3 months to build it. So it's totally custom. So I ordered it back in the early spring and the winter time, hoping I would have it over the summer, which I do. And I'm training each dog one at a time. What that does is, first of all, anytime you train a dog to do something new, it's a good idea to train one at a time, unless you have a training dog with you to help facilitate your training. But riding the bike, riding the motorcycle, there's only room for one on there at a time. And they've built the trust level in me to get on the bike and go for a ride. And it's been nothing but fantastic. The hardest part is protective eyewear. I want to protect their eyes, or because I want to be able to take them on the bigger roads. Certainly not the highways, not the super highways yet, but the bigger roads. And to do that, they're going to need eye protection. So this company, Beast Riders, makes specialized goggles, and that's the hardest part, getting a dog to wear clothing that is not normal. So Chase doesn't even like wearing the harness. That's a struggle. If he's not moving, he wants to chew his harness. You might have seen that in some of our videos. But the Beast Riders goggles are really cool because they fit the dog custom. They're custom to fit the dog, customized. And the way the strap system works, it really makes it secure on the dog. And then they have another way of attaching to it that if the dog should get them off during the ride, you don't have to worry about them because they'll still be attached to the harness. So I've trained them to ride the motorcycle first with me in the quiet of the neighborhood, just getting used to doing some turns, doing some braking, doing some speeding up, what it feels like on their body, that they are strapped in, it's all safe. And now I've taken them out to little bigger roads and starting to put the goggles on them, training them for that. So yesterday was Zorro's turn with the goggles on the bigger roads, and he just did absolutely incredibly wonderful. Hi, good boy. And you might have caught it, I did a live feed of it. Really cool. I was hoping it would hold its signal, because of course I couldn't look at the broadcast device, which is an iPhone. I had to have it up elevated in the air, and I did that, and it came out great. So that's on there. And I took him to a park to, because there he is, just laying there. We're all laying down, folks. If you can see this, it's just a beautiful sight. Everybody's content and happy. And rain clouds are moving in. I don't think it's supposed to rain till a little later, but again, that's why we're here today, in a little bit later in the evening, because if the rain comes in, we're not going to do anything, probably any activities tomorrow. Again, we've run in the rain, but only when it's necessary. When they need their activity and we haven't done anything in a few days, I call it necessary. So I took them to a park where, just a public park where I originally trained my first huskies. I haven't been there in a long time. And there was actually a police officer and his canine and his German Shepherd. And I'm well versed in that. I'm not, I don't participate in it, but I know a lot about it, because as I told you, my master trainer and mentor, that was his specialty. But I enjoyed watching the police dog with his work, and Zorro enjoyed watching it, and it was really cool. So we went there and we came back, and it's all on the Facebook WooFDriver channel. And as soon as the All Dog Network goes live, we were able to get the video up there and organized. You'll see that ride and more to come. We'll be going to certain areas. But again, it lets me spend one-on-one time with each dog. And the dynamics are totally different than when you're with two dogs, three dogs, four dogs, even five dogs, when I add Gigi to the mix. Gigi, on the run today, did the best she's ever done. And I've got the videos, and I'll be sharing them soon. Sometimes, again, I'm a little hesitant because of the blowback, for lack of a better term. Because people are like, oh my gosh, what are you doing? What are you doing? And, you know, it's nothing. People look at a picture and they gather their own thoughts. But it's extremely safe what I do. And it's actually the most fabulous way for her to socialize with the big dogs and to train her. So putting her on the scooter has just been awesome. And today, I mean, she was running. I haven't had her run yet. We go at a walking pace. So I put the huskies on with her, and if they want to run, I just put the brake on. They're growing at my speed. They know what the story is. When I command them, they go fast, slow, whatever. Even today, we saw squirrels. Chase is big on squirrels, and he'll, when we're on the trail, he'll pick up speed when we're on the trail on the bike. But on the scooter, I told him, N-O, and he just chilled. I told him easy, which means to go slow. But she picked up a pace, and she was flying. And you know what? I let her run to her heart's content because the device is safe that she's hooked on, and I wanted her to learn about her potential and to let her know that it's safe to run on the bike with the big dogs. And I can't wait to share some of that footage. I'm not sure if I'm going to share it here on the WooFDriver channel or if it's going to be shared through the group. Again, reason being because people have, it's fair game when it's out there on the internet, so when it's out there on Facebook, but when it's in the group, it's a little more private and people know my story and understand what I'm doing instead of just looking at this from a different angle, different perspective, and say, whoa, what's this guy up to? And I'm not understanding it and getting some ill feelings towards it. So that could be. I'm definitely going to share it on my website because, that's going to be on the ChineseCrestedLovers.com website. It's not there yet. The website's there, but that's for all Chinese Crested Lovers. That's the breed that Gigi is, and we had a dog before Gigi that was a Chinese Crested. They're just an awesome breed, small dog, like a toy breed, but they can participate in agility exercises as well as weight pulling and sled dog exercises, I'm finding out. So letting her explore what she can do, Gigi. Lulu wasn't as active as her, and I didn't work with Lulu as a puppy because it's more my stepdaughter's dog, but Gigi is more with my wife and I, so I have more time I could spend with her, and I'm working with her and the big dogs, and it's just been a wonderful experience. And again, I mention all this and I publish all this so people can say, hey, those are ideas I can do, especially something like what I talk about. This, I call it the dog rough board. It's a specialized scooter that's actually three wheels, so you don't need to balance yourself like a two-wheeled bike or scooter. In addition, when you get off to water the dogs or maintain them, or tend to them, excuse me, you don't have to worry about it tipping over because it's on three wheels. So they make seats for it. So if you're disabled in a way where you don't have the mobility to, or the mobility to ride a bike or to possibly walk any kind of distance, you could get on something like the scooter, attach the dog with the kind of attachments I use, any dog, and just give it a walk on there. And if it wanted to get a little more exercise, you could, it's electric, you could hit the throttle a little harder. So there's all kinds of purposes for everything I'm doing. It can be repurposed in so many ways, and so many people can benefit from it, that I love to share it. And I hope people can see those aspects of what I'm doing and learn and enjoy that and possibly take advantage of it. If you have any questions, of course, you can ask me. My websites are so, I enjoy articulating what we do because I'm excited by it, and it's quite a feat, some of this pioneering, some of this equipment we built, and some of the activities we have the dogs engage in, and seeing the dogs engage, the little dog with the big dogs, it's awesome. And it's so well documented, as I said, I'm so proud of it and enjoy it so much. I want to remember these times forever. So I share them in probably more detail than they need to be shared, but they're all available on a lot of the websites. And if they're not up there yet, like Gigi's training is not up there yet. I've just been trying to find the time. Almost all the videos are edited, and I hope to post them very soon. I've got a short clip. My wife was very proud today as she saw Gigi coming around the corner, so excited down the driveway with the big dogs, and she just felt like she was one of the big dogs enjoying herself. And she filmed it. So just a little clip, so I'll have to share that later today or tomorrow. I'm gonna check, see if we got any more questions here, folks. Let me see. And in case you didn't know, I am all over the internet, so any questions you have or any at any time, like I said, you can probably find it if you put in Google anything with WooFDriver. Cool, I don't see any new questions, but I'm looking. Yeah, unfortunately, this feed is just not showing me new questions. But, try to get there. So wonderful. I really and truly appreciate everybody's comments and all the love and all the viewership and all the likes of everything we do and all the questions. And I'd love to know what you're doing out there. And if you're using any of this wisdom that I hope to be passing on in some way, and if I can further help you or what's going on, let's see. Okay. Just had to refresh the feed. Cheryl mentioned she lots of laughs about Chase shooting stars. Yeah, Cheryl, hello to you. And I know Cheryl's been on quite a few rides with us. So with the virtually, I should say, through the webcast here on Facebook, and she's seen Chase chew his harness, and it's a battle when we stop to water the dogs or to give them a breather or to take a photo or tend to the live broadcast, and Chase is on his harness, chewing. He's a trip. That's what he does. So it's fairly common among sled dogs. Some of them will do it and will chew their harnesses off. He's really good. He just... Chewing might even be the wrong term. Maybe it's just licking at his harness because he doesn't do any real damage, which is good. But we do carry an extra harness with us in case he does chew it off because he needs a way to be able to be attached to the dog sled on wheels. And even today when he was with Gigi, he was chewing at his harness. So he's quite a character. And some of the dogs I can harness up when we're going on a trip, they can be in the harness for the whole trip ride, and some of the dogs I can't, like Chase, because he will chew it off if he's left totally unattended in the car. Well, not unattended, but if he's left to his own devices when we're in the car traveling. There he is now. He knew we were talking about him. Chase doesn't like any kind of clothes on him, so I haven't tried the goggles on him. He's probably not going to like them, but like I said, you never know. Some things, you try it. Some things work out and some things don't. When you least expect it, dogs will always surprise you. So Jim's going to engage the machine again. Got the sun coming down. He's got it, Jim. He knew where it was and he knew what you were going to do. And here we go. So, yeah. Tune in tonight. Don't forget, folks, on Brit's show, Wolf Driver News. She's always got some fun stuff cooking. And Sunday night, we've got Dean Miller, the dog counselor. He'll be airing his first show here on the Wolf Driver channel. And he'll be taking questions all about dog training. And we've got some other special shows coming up next week. And hopefully these shows, as I said, will be staples here on the Wolf Driver channel. So we'll get you times for them that you can anticipate, more scheduled times of what's going on. I'm probably going to be the most spontaneous. There's Princess. I'm probably going to be the most spontaneous because I just, you know, we never know when an activity is going to happen. It depends so much on weather and timing and everything else. But the dog trips, the big ones, are more planned out. So when I get into the dog sled, when we do our Wolf Driver on Tour, where we travel to places all over the East Coast, we do it once a week. Those trips, that's Zara zooming by, those trips are easier to plan, and they're more etched in stone. So I know this Friday we are going, not sure, depending on the weather, if it's going to be a day or nighttime run. And next Friday, I told you the 24th, will be a paranormal run, or ghost runner run, where we're going to have a ghost expert, a paranormal expert, in the house with us, in actually a haunted house we're going to explore. Of course, the dogs will all be there. They won't actually go into the house. We might bring one with us, but they'll be with the cart. Okay, here comes Zara. Love that. So he's got a lot of speed again. So it says this broadcast is going to go off in a minute or so. I might rebroadcast depending where we're at, but I'm just going to give you a mileage check. Zara's at 6.5 right now, and Princess, let me see where she's at. I can get over to there. Princess is, let's see if we can focus on this. Can you see that, folks? She's at 4.48, almost 4.5 miles. Whoa, she's flying now. She's right on Zorro. They're really good together, Princess and Zorro. Princess and Chase, they get a little headstrong sometimes. And Jag's just a prankster with everybody. So I might rebroadcast depending on how much longer we're going to stay here. Timing-wise, we're at almost 7 o'clock. Could be here another hour. So we might start another live broadcast up. And there's the flag right here. Going off in 20 seconds, folks. This is the Woof Driver, and I am signing off. I'll give you a last view of all the dogs. And might see you here shortly. You can still submit questions, and I will answer as I get to them. Hope to see you soon.